Good evening. I'd like to call to order the October 10th, 2016 legislative meeting, Board of School Directors for the School District of Upper Dublin. We are in the Cardinal Room. It is 7:01. Notice of this meeting was published in a newspaper of general circulation at least 3 days prior to tonight. I'd like to ask everybody to please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I'd like Ms. Good to lead us, please. Thank you, Ms. Good. Ms. Evans, can we have a roll call, please?
Dr. Ludwig.
Present.
Mr. Sirota.
Here.
Mrs. Goodwin.
Mrs. Good.
I mean, sorry. Mrs. Good.
I was reading this.
Mrs. Rothman.
Here.
Mr. Kim. Mr. Shimoleski.
Here.
Mrs. Hester.
Here.
Dr. Resnick.
Here.
Dr. Levinowitz.
Here. The entire board is here tonight. And I'd like to welcome everyone to tonight's meeting. I'd like to move the meeting forward with the one and only Mr. Griffin with his Student Government Association report.
Thank you, Dr. Levinowitz. Spear Week is approaching fast here at UD, as are Coronation Ball, the homecoming football game, and the Giver's performance. This year's already started off great, and the SGA has made some relatively large changes to the structure of the upcoming Spirit Week, and it has been backed pretty well by the student body and the leaders within the student body. On behalf of the SGA, I would like to extend thanks to those who stepped up and really expressed the positives for this change to Spirit Week. So thank you for that. On another note, the Upper Dublin football has had a great season with a 5-1 record, and the soccer team has gone 10-1-2. Overall, the student body is heading in a positive direction. Thank you so much.
Hey, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Griffin. We move to the superintendent's report. Dr. Wheeler.
Thank you. In a few minutes, the board is going to consider adoption of the 2016-17 annual goals. Just to do a very, very quick review, I want to walk through the 5 overarching goals, and if I can figure this out, there we go. The goals have not changed since the last time they were presented. Our first goal, of course, is equity and excellence, increasing achievement for all students. And I would like to, I'd like to spend a few minutes looking at the achievement gap metric that we're using to measure that gap. Following my presentation at the last legislative meeting, several of my correspondents inquired about the metric that presents what we are referring to as the achievement gap. Where is that shown? I responded to them, and I want to review that information now with the board. And we will do so by reviewing the school performance profile, which, of course, is an annual rating by the Pennsylvania Department of Education on our district's performance based on several metrics. I do want to tell you, the data that we're going to be looking at right now is from the 2014-15 school year, which is the last time that the SPP was published. We have been waiting. The 15-16 SPP was due to be published last week. It has been delayed by the PDE, and we are anticipating that that's going to be published soon, and we are anticipating that we will have some good news there. But before we take a specific look, I'd like to provide some quick background information. The School District of Upper Dublin has, of course, participated in state-mandated standardized testing for about 15 years since the adoption of No Child Left Behind. And those data have been reported over the years in several different ways. Initially, the published reports listed the achievement of our students on the standardized test by grade level and content area. After a baseline was established, reports were expanded and they included value added or growth measurements. A score received on the test describes the student's achievement on that test. The PVOS rating or the growth rating describes the growth over time for that student in mastering content and skills. And that was the manner of reporting student achievement data for some time. About 5 years ago, the PDE developed an additional reporting system, and that is the Strategic Performance Profile, which is designed to provide the public with a more comprehensive overview of student academic performance. The data included on this report is varied, and it includes reports on the performance and growth of all students and also of specific subgroups of students, specifically students who are identified as English language learners, students who have qualified for special education, and students who have qualified to be considered economically disadvantaged, roughly our free and reduced lunch qualification. These groups consist of a particular subgroup of students described on the SPP as our historically underperforming students, and these are the data that we're going to look at now. Again, this document can be located, just Google School Performance Profile. You'll come to this website, go to Academic Performance, and again, we're looking at the performance, the last published SPP, which represents data from the 2014-2015 school year. There's a tremendous amount of information provided here, and what I want to do is draw everyone's attention to this area. These two sections of the SPP address specifically closing the achievement gap. Again, the growth scores for those students who are identified in this area, all upside down red triangles, as you can see. This is the growth data and the achievement data for our students who make up the historically underperforming subset of students. And this is what we're referring to when we talk about the achievement gap. Overall, Upper Dublin students do very well, but we do have students, as demonstrated here, who simply are not making the progress that we need for them to make. So again, there's a great deal of information here. I don't want to delve into any more detail, but I did want to specifically show you what that metric is. So our first goal continues to be increasing achievement for all students. Our second goal addresses finances. We are purposefully and planfully reserving funds. We have a plan. It is an appropriate plan. And we are sharing that plan with all of our stakeholders, with our community. The board is intentionally saving money for several reasons, and we're letting you all know about that. Come, there's some chairs over here, folks. Come on over. We are reserving funds, of course, for an upcoming facilities project. Yes, we're looking at Sandy Run Middle School. We have several other areas, bus replacement, assessment appeals, where we are continuing to reserve funds. Facilities, again, we're looking at improvements. We're looking at renovation and preventative maintenance. We are going to begin having very preliminary conversations about what an improvement project at Sandy Run Middle School may look like. I want to stress, there is no plan at this time. There's no timeline at this time. But the board is going to start having some preliminary conversations this year. Our fourth goal addresses communication, and as you can see, our board is now using Board Docs, which is available to the community online as a way to better inform you of what's going to be transpiring at our meetings and as a record of what has happened at our meetings. And finally, our comprehensive planning. Our comprehensive plan is due to the Pennsylvania Department of Education in 1 year. And starting next Monday night, we're going to begin the process of getting that plan put together. I want to stress that there is much more to student achievement in Upper Dublin than the school performance profile that we just looked at. For our successful students, we have a great deal to celebrate. Newsweek's 2016 top high schools in the country ranked us in the top 1% nationally. Our SAT scores are the highest that they've been in 6 years. Our ACT scores are the highest that we've ever had, with an increased number of students participating. And our successful students are getting into competitive colleges. So we need to celebrate their success, but we cannot lose sight of the fact that not all of our students are succeeding, and that's where we have to apply effort in bringing those students up and in providing opportunities for our high-achieving students to really soar. So if there are questions, I will be happy to entertain those. Otherwise, that's an overview of the goals that I'm going to ask the board to adopt later this evening.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Wheeler. Are there any questions from the board? Okay, seeing none, thank you. Ms. Bray, would you kindly introduce the next presentation?
I would be delighted, Dr. Levinowitz.
Thank you.
This evening we have three individuals to speak with the entire board regarding bond refunding analysis. This is an update of what was presented on September the 15th at Finance Committee. Tonight we have with us Zach Williard. He is a senior managing consultant with PFM, and Melissa Hughes, senior analyst with PFM, and also Michael Lillies, who's a managing director from RBC Capital Markets. With that brief introduction, I'd like to turn the presentation over to them.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I think we have some really good stuff. Really good stuff in the green handout that you're going to like. You know, before we get into that, I know we've been here once or twice over the past few years for a situation similar to this where we're talking about refinancing existing debt, okay? Those were a little bit on the smaller scale. What we're going to talk about tonight is refinancing a whole lot of your bond issues, given how low interest rates are, and I think Mike Lillies from RBC will touch on interest rates here towards the end of the presentation. But if you flip to page one of the green handout, what we're showing you here is the 10-year MMD. Think of it as the 10-year Treasury, except this is the tax-exempt version, so it's a benchmark in the municipal world, okay? And if you look at the far right-hand bottom corner, you can see we're at historically low levels. You know, we did recently reach the low point in history after the Brexit vote back in June. You know, rates have come up a bit since then, but still at very, very low, attractive levels, and that's what's going to help lead to these refinancings producing very significant savings. If you flip to the next page, this is the page we always show you when we come here. It's what we call your debt summary. And you'll notice some of these columns are highlighted. But the top half, just as a refresher, is your gross debt service. Okay, so that's your principal and interest payments every year for each series of bonds that you have. The bottom half is what we call your local effort. So that's net of your state reimbursement that you should be receiving. And on the far right-hand side of each one of these is, you know, what you call your annual run rate or your budgeted debt service when you line up all these different bond issues. Now, if you take a look at the individual issues, we have a couple highlighted in a kind of a reddish color and then a few highlighted in a blue color. What we're going to do is we're going to have two steps to this refinancing plan. The first step, which is going to take place early in 2017, and that's why we want to talk about this now, is we're going to refinance all those red kind of pinkish colors. The second step will take place later in 2017 towards the summertime, in which we're going to do a cleanup issue to refinance the remaining blue series of bonds. And at the very bottom of each column, if you scroll down, you'll notice the call date. You know, we've been here a lot of times over the years. If you remember that these bond issues are issued with 5, 8, and 10-year call features depending on the size. So another kind of important point to this, as well as interest rates being low, is we're also coming up on a lot of these call dates for these old bond issues. Okay, and the closer we are to the call date, the more efficient the refinancing will be. Okay, so that's also a key point. And I also want to point you to...
Sorry about that. You're not going to be able to see it, but will this be on the website?
Yes, it
tomorrow?
Will be tomorrow.
Okay.
Yeah, so this page is a little hard to read. That's the page we were just talking about. We're going to flip to the next page. The last thing I'll say about page two before you flip it is, on the far right-hand side of each one of these, as I said, it's your total debt service. Take note of your debt service right now is a run rate of about $11 million, and then it drops off significantly in 2027 and so on as you go out. That's important to note because the way we're going to take these refinancing savings is we're not going to take them all up front as kind of one lump sum. What we're going to do is we're going to use those savings to smooth out your existing debt, okay? So we're going to lower your budgeted debt service every year there on out. So I just want you to take note of that. So real quick, we're going to skip this summary page and go to page five. I just want to do a real quick refresher on these refinancings. We're not going to go through all these pages in here. But so what we're looking at on page five is your Series A of 2008, okay? So this is in do-nothing mode. This is what your 2008 A bonds look like. Now take note, in column one, you see the final maturity of these bonds is very short. It's 2020. Then in column three, you can see the interest rate. The fixed interest rate is 4%, okay? Every year, there's a 4% there. So what we're going to do is we're going to take those old higher interest rates from 2008, and we're going to replace them with today's new lower rates. So if you flip to page 7, and again, this is just one of these bond issues. There's 7 in total. If you flip to page 7, again, note, in column 1, the final maturity is still 2020. Okay, so we're not stretching the debt out or doing anything artificial to create savings. We're keeping the same final maturity of these bond issues that you already have, and we're going to replace them with column 3. So we're going to take that 4% rate, and we're going to replace it with rates ranging from a 1.32 to a 1.66. So you can see they're fixed rates that are significantly lower than the current rates on the bonds, and that's what generates the savings. Okay, I know you all probably remember that, but I just wanted to touch on that real quick. Okay, so now we're going to flip back to this very confusing, colorful page, page 3. So each column here represents the new issue, which we're going to use to replace the old issue. Again, the old higher rates with the new lower rates. Under the blue, step 1, kind of that blue column at the top, that's what we're going to be calling the series of 2017. And inside that series of 2017, we're going to refinance 3 of those old bond issues, the 2008 A's, which are the ones we just looked at, the 2009s, and the 2009 A's. Okay? Again, this is the transaction that we would probably price early in 2017, January, February, to settle shortly thereafter. Okay? It would then replace these bonds, the old bonds. And if you scroll down each column, 11, 13, and 15, towards the bottom, you can see what we're estimating the net savings to be. Net meaning net of costs, net of negative arbitrage for each one of these. So in column one, you can see the 08 A's, that's only a $4 million issue. So the savings associated with that is just shy of $100,000. It's a small issue. The next series, the 2009s, that's about an $18 million existing issue. You're going to save almost close to $600,000 net of costs, net of state aid on that transaction. So that one's very efficient. The third one there in column 3 and in column 15, there we're talking about saving almost $1 million when we refinance that. So when we bundle all those up, that'll be your new series of 2017 bonds. At the same time, for a number of legal reasons, we're also going to refinance in a Series A of 2017.
We hit plus here a few times. Zoom in.
Okay.
And then you can use your finger and move around, right?
Helps
if you,
a little bit.
You hit plus a few times, then if there's something you want to emphasize, just. And then when you need to zoom out, just mine.
Okay, sounds good.
Thanks, Phil.
So now we're talking about this green series here. That's going to be done at the same time, but for a number of reasons, we have to have that be a separate series of bonds, so it's going to be the Series A of 2017. And you can see that is with the bulk of the savings is roughly $2.2 million at the very bottom of that green column. Okay, again, net of all costs and fees. So when we wrap all these up, we're talking about saving many millions of dollars in step one. Step two is going to be done a little bit later for a number of reasons. One of those is to make it a little more efficient. We're going to be closer to the call date at that point. So there we're talking about the purple, the orange, and the blue columns 19 through 24. Those savings are going to be slightly less You have about $160,000, 139 and 192. Again, really, you know, still really good numbers, but not as exciting as the first round. So when you total all these savings up after all the dust settles for this two-step plan next year, if you look at the far right-hand column there in the black, we're looking at about $4.3 million of net savings by refinancing your existing bond issues.
So I'm hoping you can see that from your seat. The very last column, the black column, maybe some of you can see it. Those are the savings for the bonds.
$4.3 million. Now, again, take note, as I said before, when you scroll down in column 25 there, you're not just going to take all the savings up front in your next one or two budget years for one-time projects or budgetary relief. What we're doing is we're spreading it out mostly equally over the next 10 or so years, again, to lower your annual debt service, because after that, your existing debt falls off. If you could look in the far right-hand side of this page in column 10, you can see what your existing debt looks like. Again, in 2026, it drops from 10.9 down to 9.9 and so on. So we're going to use that savings to offset budget years going out to 2026. So I'll stop there for any questions on this page, because this is kind of the kicker. This is the important part here.
Just a quick question. How conservative? I know you guys are very conservative in guessing the...
You're on to us.
Yeah, the rates. So how bad a scenario are these rates?
Well, there is a little bit of conservativeness baked in. Now, we have seen interest rates rising recently. Mm-hmm. Okay, and I'll let Mike speak to that. So, and we do still have, you know, a few months before we do step one, mm-hmm. and then step two really isn't happening until, you know, really next summer. So we do have a little bit of conservativeness built in, but not a whole lot. You know, we just have to kind of cross our fingers and hope that the rates hang in there. And with the Fed, you know, possibly increasing rates here before the end of the year and the election, you know, there's all types of things that could shake up the market. But, you know, we'll just kind of continue with this process. And that's why we wanted to get out here and start talking to you now about it, because, you know, I realize this isn't happening for a little bit, but we need to start doing all the paperwork and the legwork for this.
And we've been saying this for a number of years now, and just to remind my colleagues, interest rates were above, the 10-year was above 2% for quite a long time last year. Now it's back down again to 1.72 or something like that. So it's really has not done much.
Yeah, I think every time I've been here, and I know my colleague Jamie Doyle, we tell you we're at the lowest point in interest rate history, and then every time we come back, we're at a new low point, and it continues to be true. We're not lying to you. It's just been working out that way. So
you're putting in at least one increase, or at least one Fed increase, at least one, maybe more.
Okay. Do you want to hit on any of the market speak while we're here?
It seems like a good time to make a comment about the market. Your question was, is the market pricing in?
Yeah, can you just say who you are, sir?
Oh, I'm sorry. Michael Lillis with RBC Capital Markets.
Thank you.
The district's bond underwriter. You were making the comment about the market may be taking into account the future possible rate increase by the Fed. Most people feel right now that the market has already taken that into account. It's right now the market's basically saying that, like, about 60% chance that the Fed will raise rates in December. And that's a little part of the reason why rates have gone up recently. I think you'd mentioned and Zach had mentioned it. Another was there's been a sudden increase of supply of tax-exempt bonds in the market, and when that happens, that tends to push rates up a little higher. And then there's been some focus on the fact that the European Central Bank, not too long ago, stopped their stimulus program. And the reason that negatively affects rates is that their rates have been so low that our rates, you know, in this country have been very attractive. Now, the thinking is that if they're not trying to keep their rates as low as they have been, rates may rise, and our rates may have to rise as a result to attract investors. I mean, going forward, I mean, I think, like, until next year, when Zach was saying we're looking at pricing the first step and also later in the year, I mean, the real key factor typically is inflation. And as of very recently, inflation has been below that magic 2% level, and wage increases are just near that level. If these levels stay in place, long-term rates will probably not move too much upward. But if that changes and inflation goes up above this 2% benchmark that the Fed has pretty much been announcing for months, then you're likely to see rates go up. So keep your fingers crossed for inflation to stay, you know, where it has been.
Most of the savings come in the first set of refinancing.
That's what I was just going to say. A lot of the interest rate risk most of it is going to be taken off the table once we get to
right.
January.
Right.
So. Okay. Any other questions? So with that, we'll skip all the other pages in here and go to the very back. So what we have here is a sample motion to, you know, what this does is it gets the financing team. How do I skip pages now that I've zoomed in? There we go.
Got it. Okay.
Thanks.
So step one, we want to kind of get all the legwork started. I think I mentioned that before. There's a credit rating that we need to do. There's the preliminary official statement. There's a lot of paperwork and things that have to happen before you can actually price the bonds. What this sample motion does is it gets the team, which is PFM, the district, your solicitor, RBC, and Saul Ewing. It'll get us moving on all the paperwork. This is done with, you know, little to no cost incurred. And this way that we'll be prepared so that when we get to January, you know, we're going to be ready to go and ready to price these bonds and not have to wait anymore so that we can then take the interest rate risk off the table for, you know, what we said was a bulk of the savings. So you can see the motion there, and if you look down at the timeline, the plan would be to come back to your first meeting in January. Again, this is, you know, an estimated timeline. But to come back to that first meeting and pass what we call a maximum parameters resolution. It's the way the district's done its last number of bond issues. And what that does is it gets the team the most flexibility to price the bonds when we need to price the bonds, not on your regularly scheduled board meeting date, okay? And I know we've talked about that in depth in the past, but that's a good way, especially when we're talking about large refinancings like this and interest rates and moving around. So that would be what we would plan to do. Then we would price the bonds shortly thereafter, assuming the market's still cooperating, settle the transaction, and we'd have that first step done. Then later next year in the summertime, we would come back to do another parameters resolution for that cleanup issue for those last few bond series and go through the same process. So any other questions?
Any other questions from the board? I don't see any. Ms. Burry?
Just so that we put it in front of everyone, the first refunding would take place in the current fiscal year, and then the anticipated second would be the following fiscal year. So this is really a long-term plan, trying to take the interest risk. I'm just echoing what they said off the table as soon as what we can and lock those in at the lower rates. And it's a great plan. It can also perhaps help us fund a future project. The savings can be used in multiple ways. You'll notice that we very carefully did not take out any of the savings for the current year. Perhaps you remember last year we had some questions about how we could utilize the money that was in the 2015-16 budget with, you know, keep the IRS happy. That's not going to occur, at least in the first group. But we are in the early stages, and this is definitely subject to change.
Offhand, do we know which of these is non-referendum versus? They're all referendum. Okay, thank you. Okay. Well, looks great. Savings of $4.3 million.
At this time.
Right. Okay. At this time, I'd like to ask the presenters to just stick around for a few minutes. Looks like we are already at community input. What I'd like to ask the community is if there's any questions specifically to our council, to come up first to the microphone, ask those questions. Usually there aren't too many questions, but there could be a couple. And then after that, we'll open it up to community input in general. So if anybody would like to step up now to specifically direct questions to the bond refinancing, step up, state your name, and where you reside in the township. Petrusky.
Richard Petrusky, Fort Washington. My question would be, what will be the tax savings from refinancing the bonds and reducing the debt service? Because that's the thing I'm concerned about. Our taxes continue to go up, and I'd like to see them go down. And if you're going to do this, it would expect that your taxes will go down.
Thank you, sir. Okay, I think that's a question for the board that we'll address when we're done with community input. Any other questions regarding the board? So, again, I'd like to thank you all for coming tonight. We look forward to your return. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Okay, at this time, we open up the podium to any comments from the board. Again, 4 minutes. We do have a countdown, I believe. Ms. Evans, is that working today? We have a countdown on the screen for the 4 minutes. And she has to reset. Hold on. We'll do the old-fashioned way until, or state your name and where you reside in the township.
Okay, my name is Zhicheng Xu, spelled as Z-H-I-C-H-E-N-G, last name X-U. I live in Cheshire. First, I want to say that, to me, Upper Dublin is still a very good district. And I mean it. The evidence is that this is my 14th year living in this township. So if I don't think it's a good one, you may not have seen me anymore, right? And that does not mean I don't have any concerns. The concern is about the trend of the triangular relationship of property tax rate, and the property value, and the school rankings. And 14 years ago, when I started looking for where I should buy a house, at that time, Wissahickon is not in my radar screen at all. And Upper Dublin is a natural choice. And but nowadays, after 14 years, and that's some worrisome pattern I noticed, which I hand out to everyone, including all the school board and all the audience. The key part for my concern is the property value. And the audience and board members, look at the figure I put in there. From last school year to this school year, there's a decrease of 0.53% of assessed value. It may sound like a small number, but actually it's not. It's very worrisome. It means one out of every 187 properties was wiped out from Upper Dublin Township. So how many of that do we have if the trend continues? That's very scary. And also look at the tax rate. Our meals is 32.2861. That means 3.2286% of the assessed value. And assessed value of property is done at the county level. Wissahickon School District is in the same county as we are, Montgomery County. So the criteria of the property value assessment is equivalent. $1 assessment there and in Upper Dublin means the same thing. So look at this trend of the school ranking in the U.S. News and World Report. And we can see Wissahickon is ranked 16 in the statewide Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Upper Dublin, I don't know where to say it, it's not ranked. That's like all three combined together. I would say for people who are looking for houses, it's very hard to imagine they will choose Upper Dublin instead of Wissahickon, because for realtors, they always say location, 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 right? And Wissahickon, Upper Dublin next to each other, and property tax much lower, school arch much better. So it's natural for them to choose Wissahickon. At this point, I want the audience to help me to look at the handout I gave you. I hope you can raise it and just show it to the board, if you can. Anyone? I mean, look at this way. Just show it to the board. I put four things over there. One is wake up. The reason I want to have a W there, I'm pretty sure the school board is aware of this, but I need a W. Initiate the change, that's I. Next one, student first, that's S. Elevate rankings, that is E. That is wise. It's wise to raise the ranking, and you attract more good students, families. If you don't do
please
that...
Please finish up, sir. Your time is up.
Okay. Then I think I present all my case, and I do have some suggestions. I talked to Dr. Wheeler. I think I will talk to her like in more details regarding basically after the quiz. I hope the school will give back the questions, the answers, and the correct answers. Only when students know what they are wrong, their weakness, then they can improve it better. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Okay. Anyone else, please? To save time, if you do want to address the board, if you can just start a line. I don't know how many additional individuals would like to speak tonight.
Hello. Thank you, everyone. My name is Xin Kai Kong. I'm a resident of Maple Glen. My older son graduated from high school a couple of years ago. He's in the Naval Academy.
Stop the clock, please, Brooke.
And my daughter is in Sandy right now, seventh grader, and my younger son is in Maple Glen as a first grader. So first of all, I want to say I love this community. My three kids love this community. We love this school district. Let me start by saying that a few years ago, I was one of the advocates for building the new high school, knowing that we were going to pay higher tax, because I believed that this was a big investment on our children's education and future, and also the investment on our property. A few years passed. Well, I'm not saying our school system failed. We dropped. Maybe it's because other neighboring school districts improved. So, relative speaking, our school district's ranking is not so satisfactory in recent few years. So, starting from a couple of years ago, I saw some of my friends moved out because of this. I knew some friends were already thinking moving in, they hesitated. But now, this become a definite trend because everybody I talked to, even in my neighborhood, they were talking about like, why did we pay so high tax and our school ranking is not that attractive. And I know my friends, they don't even think about moving to this community anymore, which let me feel sad, bad, because I lived here for more than 10 years, over 10 years. I love this community. I do believe we have a very good community. It's just because like somehow, something, you know, I don't know. I mean, but like it's like this kind of sentiment is not that so promising. So I just don't want the board to view this as a kind of like a confrontational emotion. I would rather say it's like let us feeling to be heard, to be listened, our voice be listened, and then whether there is any cooperative way, constructive way, community, school board, together, we think about a way how to make the change, how to improve. I'm not saying this we're doing bad, performing bad. I'm saying how we can perform better to keep pace with the neighboring school district, or like at least to improve to the level that we were at before. So this is basically all that I want to say. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Hi.
Hi, my name is Michael Bartley. I live in Willow Grove. I just wanted to bring to the board's attention that my daughter started Sandy Run Middle School this year. It's her first time taking the bus. And there are some issues with our bus schedules where they're very confusing to the kids for the first timers. She generally takes a number 26 bus, if that's her designated bus. It's always late. So she has been getting through the courtesy of a different bus driver, he picks her up at a different bus stop that wasn't designated for her every day. Today, he wasn't there, unfortunately. My daughter doesn't know the rules specifically. So she got on the number 26 bus today, which is her designated bus for the first time. She got to her seat. The bus driver then stopped, asked her, does she normally take this bus? She said no, but didn't get a chance to explain, and the bus driver told her to get off the bus. Now, she was on the bus going to her school, and the bus driver acknowledged that, but then told her to leave the bus. Luckily, my wife had not left her work yet. She was able to get her off to school, and my daughter was fine with it, but when she got home, she explained it to my wife over the phone, and it's become a big contention. My wife contacted the director of transportation's office, and she was told that they're not going to they will not release the bus schedules or pickup spots for publicly because it's for the safety of the students. It's really confusing for people who've never taken the bus before, and especially a little girl who has to take it on her own. And I'm also worried about the fact she was asked to leave the bus knowing it was going to her school. I assume that once she's on the school's bus, she's now responsible, the bus driver is responsible for getting my daughter there. Luckily, there wasn't a problem, but there could have been. And I just want to bring it to the board's attention that that is an issue. The director of the transportation system is going to discuss it with my wife, but I also just wanted everybody, parents, and the board to be aware that this did happen today. All right. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Rich Petrusky, Fort Washington again. There was some discussion here about this program to achieve to address the achievement gap. And one thing that was not mentioned was the cost to put this program in place. And again, this is going to have an effect on our taxes, and I'd like to know what the cost is going to be. Another one is the Blue Ribbon Schools that was recently listed in the Philadelphia Inquirer. And I noticed that Upper Dublin was not in that list. Wissahickon was, as was White Marsh, which is part of the Colonial School District. And I've noticed over the past couple of years that Upper Dublin seems to be dropping in the rankings. We also always were rated one of the higher schools in the district, and something's happened that we're not in this ranking anymore, and I'd like to know what the reason for that is. And recently at another board meeting, a water polo was put in place as an official sport in the school system, and I'd like to know what the cost of that is, because originally, the parents were going to pay for water polo, and now it's become an official sport, and the taxpayers are going to pay for it. So I'd like to know what the cost is going to be for that as well. Thank you.
Okay, anybody else?
Hello, my name is Su Hong Liu from Maple Glen. Yeah, I'd like to take this opportunity and...
Brooke, the time.
First of all, is about it's actually Mr. Xu and somebody else already mentioned actually talk about the school, the rank, right? And this topic actually talking about it's probably 4 years already, and we get some response say, hey, this is not objective, this is like subjective, maybe the rank. He is high, he is low, right? But for the resident, okay, and for the student, I think the rank overall is object, because the results back is, the property value, because of the rank, right? Property value will be, lower, right? Then for students, the opportunity to go to better school will be, smaller too, okay? And also, recently the drama, the Temple University, the drama, right? And recently Temple University rank, they actually bump like from 100 to 80, something like that, and everybody happy. And the president happy, and the vice president happy. but they all want to take a credit, okay? But eventually become to friendly fight or internal war, you know? So results two, ones be fired, ones resign, whatever, you know? So, but the example here is ranking is actually very important and actually affect everybody interest, you know, no matter, you know, it's student, family, teacher, right, and, you know, administrator too. So I know recently, actually last semester or what, you know, it's, we have school try to push, like, refine the grade, right? So I don't know what is the results of that or when we'll implement for that refined grading system. So this is something, you know, we only know, okay, you have this kind of a motion, but we're not here when we'll implement, you know, or what's the date, whatever. But finally, I like to say something is I like to borrow from this presidential campaign. They have two slogans, okay? One is make America great again. So I like to say make UDSD great again. Okay, this is number one. Number two, another slogan says stronger together. But I would like to say together stronger, okay? Because if we want to make school better, not just parents, not just students, not just administrator, okay, also include the teacher. So I know teacher is a teacher union, most responsibility is negotiate like a contract, but I'm not sure is their responsibility to evaluate teachers' performance or motivate teacher, you know, improve their performance. You know, this is something we want teacher union be part of game to make school better. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Jen Kuznets, Fort Washington. I'm just wondering if maybe there's a lot of issues with transportation, and I'm just curious as far as why the transportation director hasn't, like, he's not at any of these meetings when we know that we've had a lot of transportation issues, not only this year but last year. What happened with that software that we bought that was supposed to solve everything? It was tens of thousands of dollars worth of routing software that we spent, and I'm just wondering, it's gotten worse, to be perfectly honest, and why it seems that it seems like such a combative atmosphere if you have a child with a bus stop issue, you know, and the parent doesn't feel safe. I mean, to me, if they can be picked up 50 feet extra down the road, then it really shouldn't be a sorry, too bad for you, we think it's just fine. You know, it's the little things like that that really go a long way as far as making people feel good about the district. And to piggyback off the last gentleman, as far as the, you know, including the teachers, I have to say the classroom sizes are getting bigger. They're getting a little bit here and there bigger. They are art. And, you know, the teachers are being pushed and pulled and 14 different directions in all this new curriculum. I definitely heard a lot of frustration about the new English language arts in the beginning and how it was kind of crammed in there. It felt very last minute. A lot of teachers aren't sure even what to do with it yet. They haven't had that much time. The materials 2 weeks before school, at least in one building I know of, weren't even there. So it's, you know, sometimes the change just to change or to try to make it better, it, you know, a long-term plan might be a little bit better as opposed to trying to make a decision and just cram it in there last minute. I do feel like it's left some teachers, you know, a little bit frustrated. And then, you know, frankly, when you're at a job and you're frustrated, you just don't care as much. And I think that when we're pinching the teachers and we're, you know, they're getting turned at every angle and they have to, you know, teach to 14 different levels, at least on the elementary school, it's hard. It's, you know, they need more help. Thank you.
Okay, seeing no one else, we will start answering the questions. Let's take the bus schedule first and transportation and software, get that done first. Ms. Bray?
Certainly. We did buy software 2 years ago, and we have been attempting to implement it, but the price was not tens of thousands of dollars. I will have to refresh my memory on that. Through the years when we haven't had a transportation director, we were adding a lot of stops. And I'll be more than happy to talk with the father about what happened today. It's important that when we know what buses all of our children are on, bus drivers need to have a roster just for safety reasons in case, God forbid, there's an accident or anything. I'm very dismayed to hear that a driver asked a student to get off the bus once he or she was on there. I believe you said daughter. And I'll be addressing that with the director of transportation tomorrow morning. The reason we cannot add all the stops that everyone wants, we would need more buses and more drivers. Every time a bus stops, whether it's 50 feet away, and actually there are PDOT requirements about how frequently, how close together bus stops can be, we add between 2.5 and 3 minutes to a run. So logistics, there is a lot going on. I have been spending a lot of time trying to get together the 2017-18 bus runs already. But I certainly will take your comments and chat with you more. Any other questions or anything, Dr. Levinowitz, that you particularly want me?
Not on the bus. Are there any additional comments from the board regarding the issue, Mr. Bartley? No? Okay. But thank you for coming, and we appreciate your comments. Thank you. Okay. Let's look at the property. Let's look at that one-page handout, Ms. Bray, I think Mr. Roos has something to say, and maybe you and then something.
Yes.
I do want to be clear about something. The overall assessment of a school district doesn't necessarily indicate, the fact that it rises or falls doesn't really have anything to do necessarily with property values in the townships. The last time the county did a countywide reassessment was 1998. That means unless a property was, their assessment was appealed at some point during between 1998 and now, the assessment hasn't changed. So the overwhelming majority of properties in this township assessment hasn't changed since 1998. Now what you will see have happened is people who have appealed their assessments, either residential or commercial or industrial, and if anybody appeals their assessment, generally speaking, that means one of two things ultimately happens. Either the assessment doesn't change, usually what happens, or sometimes the assessment will go down. Occasionally the school district will, and the township will take an assessment, and in that case, the assessments will go up. Another thing that could affect the total overall assessment in the township is the amount of property that becomes nonprofit or that becomes government-owned. And there's been quite a bit of property acquisition over the last 18 years by the township and by nonprofits. All of these things are going to affect what the total assessment is in the township. And it's got nothing really to do with real estate values. So it's really not a reliable or even, it's almost an unreliable indicator of overall property values.
And if I could, most of the assessments where we've lost our assessed value in Upper Dublin has really been in the Fort Washington office park through the years. And there are no homes and certainly no children coming from that area. We have had, as Mr. Roos said, some success on some properties where we have increased the assessed value. But that number does fluctuate as much as $500,000 a month. So what the assessed value was on June 30th, 2016 has changed several times. We will have a major change as of January 1, 2017, and I know there will be more changes as we move through the next budget cycle.
Okay, comments from the board on this topic? Dr. Ludwig?
I have a few things, and I'm trying to think which order to address them. One is, one of the things that you will notice in your handout, if you look at the total assessed value, your first two columns, and compare Upper Dublin and Wissahickon, So the value of the assessed value in Wissahickon is about a third larger than Upper Dublin. Part of that is because Wissahickon is two townships and a borough. It has about 26 square miles of property. Upper Dublin is about, I think it's about 13 square miles of property. So, I mean, that puts the people in the Wissahickon School District at an advantage in that they can raise the same amount of money as Upper Dublin can with a much lower tax rate. Now, the kind of things that we can do about that, I mean, is to try to grow the usable assessed value in the township. One of those ways, and there is a lot of effort within the township, more on the township side, in trying to revitalize and improve the office park. The township has worked very hard to get a number of grants with flood retarding structures and improvements to to build up the property in the office park so that if that improves, then the assessed value of the property in the township would go up without increasing. So the amount of money we could raise at the property tax level would go up without any increase on individual homeowners. The other kinds of things that are going on are things like trying to develop the Regency housing development that's going in on Welsh, the potential development across Dresher Town Road from that, the promenade, the area at the villa, St. Mary's. Those are three properties that, if they are developed, will significantly help bring money into the town, into the district, so that we can do things like fix Sandy Run, not raise taxes. Those are the kinds of things that would help in terms of bringing money in without increasing tax rates. The other thing, now maybe I'll let other people talk for a minute, but I guess I do have a couple other things about how rankings work. I looked at rankings last spring, and although, I understand the comments about how people look at rankings, they look at the tax rates, and they make a decision on the schools. I think that if you look at what is the school doing for my individual child, the rankings don't necessarily tell you what that means in terms of the education. I can explain a little bit about the U.S. News ranking, because there are a number of, the way the ranking works is actually fairly complex, and I don't know if any of you have ever studied what it is that the ranking is based on and why it is that we did not make it. I don't see anyone saying they've studied it. There are a number of filters, and then there's another basis for ranking. The filters have to do primarily with how well the district educates its economically disadvantaged students. And we didn't pass that filter, just barely, but we didn't pass that filter. So that's why we're off the ranking. It's really not about the quality of the education overall. It's a specific measure. And obviously we would like to do better because people do pay attention to rankings. I guess those are the comments.
Okay. Any other comments on the property tax rate, assessed value?
Yeah, I have one.
Who's that? Mr. Yeah. Sirota. Yes, sir.
Joan covered a lot of this, but something to add is the school district, so these measures, we all obviously would like taxes to be lower, rankings to be higher. It's not completely up to the school district. There's only so many knobs that the school district can turn. The township can turn other ones. And I would encourage residents of Upper Dublin to talk to your commissioners about this too, because especially for the assessed value one, as Joan explained, that's where those decisions happen. So the town, we are lucky, in my opinion, in this district to have the same borders between our township and our school district. So when something affects us positively, it affects the township positively. When something affects the township positively, it affects the school district positively. So for issues like this, it all works together. And also, please, so and it, thank you for the comments. Please also talk to your commissioners.
Okay. Any other comments from the board regarding the property tax rate, assessed value? Okay. I think there's advantages and disadvantages of living in a very small community. You're paying for it a little bit. If you look how much larger Wissahickon is and what their assessed value is, that's why their taxes can be lower. Now, we've also committed to a new high school, which created an additional 16% tax increase over the past, over 3 years. That increase will be in the taxes until that debt is gone. So we're paying for this new high school for 20 years. We realize that. We've made... I really don't want to say, I don't want to compare us to Wissahickon in terms of what they offer and what we offer. I would not, I've lived in this community for since 1988. I continue to compare what they do, type of education they deliver, the type of education we deliver. And my personal opinion is you know, I would not consider moving out of Upper Dublin. And to talk more about... we'll talk more about the rankings, I think, if there's any other comments. But we are available to talk to the organization if you'd like us to come in and talk again and share with you some of the nitty-gritty, some of the data that results in our not being ranked by U.S. News and World Report. We did rank highly in Newsweek, 14th, 16th. I don't remember what that ranking
was. We were 30th in Pennsylvania and 330th nationally on Newsweek.
On Newsweek. So it's the top 1%. And then most recently, School Digger came out with rankings. And if you look at the high school, you'll see what you think would happen to Wissahickon. Wissahickon went down. Upper Dublin went up significantly. Year to year, those rankings will change. There was a question asked about our grading system, and understand that our internal grading system will not affect, Ms. Morrison, correct me if I'm wrong, will not affect the rankings. The rankings are based on Keystone, PSSAs, number of students that take the advanced placement and how they score, graduation rate is part of the SPP. When the SPP comes out, I really urge you to look at the SPP, all levels, especially the high school, and you can look and see where we lost points. The Keystone and PSSA scores, the raw data is already out. So we've seen the raw data, but we haven't seen the SPP. You can go on PDE site and see Keystone exams for last year. And we plan to do a presentation on that next month. So once the SPP comes out, it fluctuates. It changes. And it depends on what the emphasis is in each building and what your curriculum is. We realized that our curriculum in ELA, English Language Arts, was not tied to the Pennsylvania standards. So we have changed that curriculum. And now we get criticized for changing that curriculum. But for us to do better... For our students to be prepared for the 21st century, based on the Pennsylvania standards, we needed to move to ReadyGen. So, first year of implementation, I'll ask Ms. Morrison to speak a little bit about what we've done in terms of implementing ReadyGen. The comment was made that teachers were not ready. There wasn't professional development. The materials didn't come on time. Ms. Morrison, can as director of curriculum, assessment, instruction,
professional development.
Development.
Thank you, Dr. Levinowitz. May I just want to back up for a moment to go back to 2014 when the state of Pennsylvania put in new PA core standards. Those are very, very rigorous standards in reading and mathematics. They're so rigorous, in fact, that this year's eighth graders in the state of Pennsylvania were only proficient at 30%. Only 30% of our eighth graders this year, not in Upper Dublin, but in the state. So you can see how difficult those tests are. They're extremely difficult, and they, and the entire state is getting used to the new rigorous standards. We implemented a new mathematics program to match those standards 2 years ago. Every time a new program comes in with the ensuing shift in instruction, there is always a time of uncertainty among the teachers, and it always takes time to get used to the new materials. It takes time to learn how to teach with the new materials, and I think we are in the midst of that with English language arts. We did have some delay in materials that was entirely beyond our control. However, Pearson, the textbook company, was very apologetic and has redoubled their effort and provided some additional complimentary professional development because of the way that they delivered the materials. So we were very, very sensitive to that. And then I guess, was there another part of your question, Dr. Levinowitz?
Professional development, what we do for ELA?
Yeah, we are doing ongoing professional development. We have specialists coming in, meeting with our teachers. They've been in several times. We will continue to have both on-site, building site, and classroom site professional development to help with the English language arts implementation, as well as full days on November 8th, and we'll be using our half days as well.
Okay, Dr. Wheeler?
Yes, there was, I think it was Mr. Petreski had a question about the achievement gap and the costs for the program to improve. If only it were as simple as a program. We have implemented changes throughout our educational program, the way we're doing business. A complete overhaul of our curriculum, and that has included a new mathematics curriculum at the elementary level, the new English language arts curriculum. We have had a tremendous shift in instructional practice. We've had the infusion of technology that our teachers have been playing a lead in. Our teachers have been remarkable leaders in that. And as far as professional development, we've done a tremendous amount of professional development, not only for our teachers, but also for our administrators. So we are looking at many ways in addressing this achievement gap. We have reduced some levels at the high school in some of the content areas. We've added extra supports. So coming up with one quantitative, one number to include all of that would be very difficult. But again, bear in mind, the state has changed over the last several years the way they are reporting the data. And I look forward to a conversation, make an appointment, we'll have a conversation and look into it. But that has really revealed the fact that we have a subgroup of students who are not achieving the way we would like them to achieve. We're addressing that. But we're also not losing sight of the needs of our higher achieving students. We have, as you know, a study of our gifted program going on right now so that we can add more enrichment for the students who are higher achieving. So all in all, we know that we have an issue, we uncovered it, we are addressing it, and I think that's everything that we had to speak about the achievement gap.
Okay. Okay. You can ask any questions at this point. There's another period of community input at the end of the meeting that you can. Regarding the Blue Ribbon Schools, and we congratulate our neighboring schools for reaching that achievement. We were recognized as a Blue Ribbon School in the 90s, so we've already done that, and it's both our middle school and our high school were recognized as Blue Ribbon Schools back in the 90s. So
also Thomas Fitzwater.
And Thomas Fitz. Yeah, it's Yeah, so and there was a question regarding water polo, the cost. There is a motion tonight, and the estimated cost is in the agenda. I believe it was $20,000 was the estimated cost for water polo. To remind the community, at the time that we agreed with working with the water polo program, we are now in the third or fourth year, help me? Fourth year. I thought it was the fourth year. The original agreement was we were hoping that we would not have to make a commitment for 5 years, but after working together with the team, with the athletic director, with the coaches, we have a motion tonight to move it forward as an official sport here at Upper Dublin after 4 years of it being totally self-funded by the water polo program and by UD and by the swim team.
Part of the reason for this recommendation on my part was to help our students have. And I want to welcome all of our members of the Water Polo Club. Thank you for being here tonight. We'll let you go soon so that you can go home and study. But it was to really formalize the arrangement and have some parameters about how many students, how many athletes would participate on the teams, to better define the teams, varsity, junior, varsity, and to look at equitable sharing of our swimming pool. So it was in everyone's best interest to go ahead, and given the demonstration of our athletes that they are committed to this sport, the recommendation is now being made that we go a year ahead of time. So very proud to have made that recommendation.
Okay, and I keep going back to school ranking. I think it's because it's something that I'm very interested in. It's something I'm very aware of, and I understand where, you know, many of you are coming from regarding the school ranking. It's a two-way conversation, and we'd like to continue the conversation. There's a lot of concern about the SPP. There's been a lot of work done in the SPP. About the validity of the test, the U.S. News rankings. There's many things that I find very troubling in terms of how you have to get through that filter. We've recognized for a number of years that we have an issue with our historically underperforming students, and that keeps coming back, and that keeps affecting why our scores are where they are, and I do a lot of looking, a lot of research, a lot of time I'm looking at scores. I downloaded the entire state raw data file of all the PSSAs and Keystones. I drive the administration crazy with my analysis, hoping to see, where the problems are, where are we doing better. And I think when we do the presentation next month, you'll see that there's going to be some very good movement in our results with the Keystone and in ELA and in math and at the high school. Scores are very, very good. That data is already available. We're not doing the presentation yet because we need to wait for the SPP. As we quickly said earlier, this is just, again, my opinion, nobody else's. SATs is critical. SATs are critical. You could have 101 score in the SPP, but I really want to know, how are they doing on SATs? What kind of services is the district with the SATs? Last year we were tied for 14th in the state for SATs, and for me that is an objective, very important measure. Obviously, we want to do better in all of the rankings because we understand. People look at the rankings and how important it is for them. We're working on it. We are working. I think we realize that we have to do better in some of those rankings, even though we probably feel it's the validity of some of those rankings leave a lot to be desired. When you look at the rankings, look at some of the other districts that don't do as well as our neighbor. And some of them are also recognized as very high achieving successful districts. It depends on what emphasis each district has and how important they feel years ago those rankings played with that district years ago. But we do realize the need for us to do better in the rankings, and we are working on it. There's a lot going on in the district to reduce that achievement gap. And once we do better with that, it doesn't happen overnight. It takes a couple of years. But I truly feel that we as a board understand the concerns. We have a very good understanding or appreciation why we're scoring low on some of these rankings, and then other rankings we do very well. So we're working on it. If you come to our education committee meetings, you'll hear specifically what we're doing in terms of the elimination of one of the tracks at the high school, all the curriculum that we're implementing, the additional software that we're purchasing, the one-to-one initiative that's going on. So, you know, we get your concerns, and any of us are available to meet with the organization. You know, if you'd like to talk about this further and look more deeply at the data, especially when the SPP comes out. You know, let's see where that is. I spoke a lot. Sorry about that. But does anybody else want to address any of the...
I believe there was a question.
There's one other question on class size that Jen had. I think we have the enrollment report. Nita, okay, go ahead.
I believe there was a question about when the new grading system would go into effect.
Yeah, it is.
Okay. And it's my understanding that the grading system went into effect in September.
Correct.
And it is relevant for all grades at the middle school and the high school.
Correct. Getting back to class size, the enrollment report is the first item in the education committee. It's an FYI item. I think our class sizes are excellent. If you want to disagree, you can disagree. Show me the evidence that shows that it is not. Look at all the other districts in the area, find out what their enrollment is. Don't just say to me 25 is a high number. It's not. Depends on the grade, depends on how we deliver the instruction. It's not. Look at what those numbers are in kindergarten, 1 and 2, which are most critical. Those numbers are very impressive for us, and we're proud of those numbers in all four of our elementary schools. Mr. Sroda, anything else, sir?
Yeah, two more. Okay. Well, one class size is, this is the first year since, I think, 13-14, that all of our class sizes are under our policy.
Suggested cap.
Our target listed in policy. So since 13-14, at least, I think it can't be true that they've been going up. This is the first year that every single class has been within target. There was also a comment about the Teachers Association, that they should be part of the game to make the school better. It's my opinion they very much are. They are. Do you want to talk to that, Dr. Wheeler?
I will be more than happy to. The work, the engagement of our teachers in rewriting curriculum, paying a lot of attention to our embedded assessments, bringing on board our technology initiative. Our teachers have been working very, very hard, very enthusiastically. We all understand that there's going to be some frustration over change, again, going back to the new English Language Arts curriculum. But I can tell you the work that our teachers have done, at least in the time that I've been here, the last several years, we are all very proud of the efforts, and it really has become a team effort. We're all working together. Teachers, administrators, staff. So, yes, Dr. Ludwig just reminded me, we have a rather unique setup here in Upper Dublin. We have a group of teachers. They come from each of the buildings. They meet on a monthly basis with Mrs. Morrison and Dr. Miner and myself, and we talk about the initiatives that we are planning. We plan professional development, and we do that collaboratively so our teachers have an active voice at the table. The changes that we're implementing, we're not doing things to people, we're doing things with people, and I think that's been another tremendous shift that is adding to the sense of enthusiasm here in the district. We're all committed to making things better for each and every student in the district. So, yeah, thank you for bringing that up, Mr. Sirota.
Mrs. Sirota.
There was one more question.
Yeah, I think I have it.
Okay, go ahead.
Teacher evaluation.
No, that wasn't the one.
There was one on teacher evaluation.
The one I had, Mr. Petruschi asked about what would the tax savings be from refinancing the bond and reducing the debt service. That really is a separate question. This is, refunding the bonds. The tax discussion is done annually through the budget process, and they're really not directly tied together.
Thank you.
And I can certainly address evaluation. We have a system that is dictated by the Pennsylvania Department of Education and the legislature, and we are deeply engaged in that for the evaluation of our teachers and of our administrators. And again, if you want to come in, make an appointment, I'll be happy to go through all the details of that so that you're fully informed.
Okay. We tried to answer all the questions. Thank you for sitting patiently. But we take your comments, your questions very seriously, and I'm hoping we can continue the two-way communication. Okay, moving on to our actual agenda, which moves fairly quickly. So we'll be at that next community input within at least 4 or 5 hours. So. No, it won't take too long. It won't take too long. Okay, minutes. Do we have any minutes, Ms. Bray?
Yes, we do this evening. We would ask that the board approve minutes from the legislative meeting on August the 22nd as well as September the 12th, Finance Committee minutes from September the 15th, minutes for the Education Committee for the date of September the 26th, as well as the Policy Committee, which also took place on September the 26th.
Okay, is there a motion to approve the 5 sets of minutes? Is there a second?
Second. I have a change to one.
Okay.
To the policy under, Brooke, if you're hearing this, under policy 222, it said first reading of P-222 on 10-31-16. It's 10-10-16.
Okay.
Thanks.
Okay, the reason we were doing a much better job getting the minutes out, there is one set of minutes from August. The reason we have the delay, we used to have a 3 or 4 month delay back years ago, is that we're now putting the minutes in board docs. And once the minutes are approved, Brooke, community would be able to see it in board docs or on board docs? And it goes right to the minutes. Okay. You can click on each agenda and the minutes would appear. So if you need any assistance, just let Brooke know. Okay, we have 5 sets of minutes to approve. 5 minutes? Okay. First and second, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, moving on to the Education Committee, curriculum recommendations, Dr. Ludwig.
The first item, as Dr. Levinowitz indicated, is for your information. It is the enrollment report. So, again, if you look at the agenda and click on the link that says enrollment report, you can look at the details. The next, out of the motions in the Education Committee, a number of them were covered completely at the Education Committee meeting. And there are a couple new things which I'm going to mention first, and then we will take them all together. So in the student activities, one was covered. There are 3 new things. One is a trip for the Future Business Leaders of America in November. There is one that is a trip for the Region 6 orchestra students to go to Westchester, that's in March. And there's another orchestra trip, District 11, traveling to Upper Marion for 2 days in January. The other changes since the Education Committee are there are some additions to the listings in the conferences, and those are available in the in the handout for the agenda. So I move that we accept all of these motions.
Okay, do we have a second? Okay, so we are approving at this point the student activities, the Act 80 exemption day, state and federal funds for 2016-2017, and conferences. Anything that was not discussed at this point was discussed there at the Education Committee last week. Okay, anything?
Okay. Are there any comments?
Any comments or questions? Okay, seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, thank you. Moving on to, people services. Okay.
Sure, there are three agreements to approve. There's two service agreements and one education agreement. The first is to authorize approval of an independent contract for occupational therapy not to exceed $10,000. The second is to authorize approval of an independent contract to provide LTS behavioral specialist services not to exceed $20,000. And the last is to approve additional funds for the BCIU for special education student for last year's school year for an amount not to exceed $8,300.
Okay. Mr. Kim made the first?
Yes.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any comments or questions on these two service agreements and the one educational agreement? Okay. Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay. Moving on to facilities. Mr. Chmielewski.
All right, there's only one motion. It's to approve the list of excess, obsolete, and non-repairable equipment for disposal as listed. Move approval on that.
Second.
Okay, there's a first and a second. Comments or questions on that list? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anyone opposed? Moving on to finance. Dr. Resnick.
Thank you. Under the finance report, I'd like to go out of order tonight.
Okay.
And go right to letter D.
D for water polo?
D for water polo. And recommending that the board approve water polo as an interscholastic team sport for 2017 to 2018. Approving the addition of water polo, requested financing will support a program consisting of varsity and junior varsity boys teams and a varsity girls team. The background is, for the past 3 years, the cost of water polo have been supported by the efforts of parents and athletes through various fundraising efforts. The estimated cost for the three water polo teams is approximately $20,000.
Right, and it's 3 years plus this year. So it's, right? Okay. Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, first and a second. Comments or questions? Well, since nobody cares about this program, I don't know why we have to. No, I we do appreciate your patience and your all of your input in asking us to move this program up. As the coach knows, I've been to some of the games, and I know there was a couple of victories at some competitions that you've had for the first time. So we're very excited to potentially move this forward to see if we have the votes. So again, I will strongly support that we move forward with this program, and I wish all of you. This shows us why you know, this is what we do. What we do. I mean, we tried this out for 4 years. We weren't sure about it, and I think just seeing the participation, the commitment that you have for this program with your coaches. That's, I think, why I'm recommending that we move forward. Any comments or questions? Okay, it was first and second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay. Go home and study. We look forward to additional success, and thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Greiner, for moving this through, too. Mr. Greiner. And Coach. Yanni. Okay, Dr. Resnick?
Okay, further, the treasurer's report is letter A and the vouchers list, letter B. We usually take those together. Treasurer's report for September 2016, the food service trial balances for July 2016 and August 2016, and the Upper Dublin High School student activities accounts trial balance for September 2016, and the vouchers as listed under B.
Okay. Second, Mr. Sirota. This is for approval for the treasurer's report and voucher list. Any comments or questions? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay.
Letter C is about the bond refinancing. We had a presentation tonight. We had a presentation at the Finance Committee meeting. This is recommending that the school board authorize the business administrator to work with PFM Financial Advisors, LLC, as financial advisor, RBC Capital Markets, LLC, as underwriter, and Sol Ewing, LLP, as bond counsel in conjunction with the issuance of one or more series of general obligation bonds via a negotiated sale for the purpose of refunding all or a portion of the school district's general obligation bonds, Series A of 2008, Series of 2009, I'm not sure. Is that reading right?
Yes.
It
okay.
is.
There's an A. There's a blank and an A. There's
and then Series A of 2009 and Series of 2010. Current interest rates are lower than when these general obligation bonds were issued. The proposed current and advance refunding of these general obligation bonds will result in substantial interest savings over the remainder, the remaining life of the bonds.
Second.
Second by Mr. Sirota. Any comments or questions? I would like to acknowledge and thank the administration for working with the groups to and for keeping interest rates as low as they are. I know it's
right. Thank you.
And just the savings, just to say $4 million is a great savings for the district, and most of it is in part one. So regardless of what happens when we do the second part, it's not even maybe $500,000 savings, maybe a little bit more, I believe. But it's in the handout. Any other comments or questions?
Well,
Dr. Ludwig.
One thing that we were told at the Finance Committee meeting is that there's actually a lot of work going into figuring out the scheduling of the various payments, because the way you make the arrangement of how the issues go and they wrap around and they spread out over the term, there's a fair amount of work, and we really appreciate that they worked hard to get it in a way that would be most advantageous for us.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. We did not vote. Right. Okay. So right. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay. One more item. Dr. Resnick.
Lastly, making a motion to approve a stipulation and settlement agreement among the district, Upper Dublin Township, the Montgomery County Board of Assessments Appeals, and Drescher Hill RE 1 LP in connection to parcel number 54-00-03643-00-2 located at 1380 Camp Hill Road. Based on this stipulation to settle, the district is instructed to refund $32,715 in total for the years 2010 to 11, 2011 to 12, and 2012 to 13.
Okay. Second, Mr. Sirota. Comments or questions? Okay. Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay. Moving on to personnel. Ms. Hester.
I make a motion to approve the personnel recommendations as listed in letters A through H.
A through H. You want to do the extracurricular too, or you just want to do A through H? What's that? I know.
I'll just do A through H right now.
Okay, A through H. Motion to approve. I'm going to get there. Okay, to approve A through H. Ms. Hester made the motion. Is there a second? Ms. Good made the second. Okay. Comments or questions? Okay, seeing none. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
I make a motion to approve item I, the approval of a contract
Okay, this is item I.
With Therapy Source Staffing Solutions in the amount of $16,000.
Okay, this is because of a Do Not Compete course for one of our new psychologists, I believe. Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Ms. Goods, it's the second motion. Comments or questions? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, moving on to
extra. And I make a motion to approve the extracurricular activities in item J.
Second?
Second.
Second, Ms. Good. Any comments or questions? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? I'd like to bring everyone's attention to what we just did in the change of status. Decision was made to move Mr. Albert, who was our assistant principal, world language coordinator, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and promote him, I believe, to assistant principal at Sandy Run Middle School. And the board is very pleased that I believe Mr. Albert will accept the position. he better. And I wanted to give him an opportunity to speak. Mr. Albert will be in the Sandy Run Middle School full-time as the second assistant principal. Years ago, we did have two assistant principals in that building, and we're very pleased that we've been able to find an excellent, skilled person to take over as second assistant principal, Mr. Albert.
Thank you very much. Just wanted to say thank you to the school board, Dr. Wheeler, Mr. Sigafoos, for this opportunity. I've been working in part for the past year as the assistant principal, and I'm really looking forward to getting to work further with the staff at the middle school. It's been a great first year for me down there, and I've really been impressed by a lot of the things going on down there, and I'm really excited to see where we could head down there as a school and then also as a school district. I'd also like to thank three additional people. First, Jan Froner, who's not here, obviously. She was world language coordinator when I first got hired. Someone that really introduced me to Upper Dublin and showed me Upper Dublin's ways, and it really is a great place to work. And it's a great place to have students, and it's a great place to raise a family as well. I'd like to thank Ava Morrison, who was my German colleague for many years and world language coordinator, and somebody who never let the grass grow under my feet, so to say, and was always pushing to promote me, and is a great friend of mine as well. And I'd also like to thank Chris Michener at the high school for all his support and help that he had. And thank you all.
Thank you. And Ms. Al, I didn't know there was another, you also did some teaching, point four, point two, while in addition
two
to
courses, yep.
Two courses,
point
yes.
Four.
Yeah, so we do look forward to your work at the middle school. Any other comments, questions? Okay, moving on, policy, Ms. Rothman.
Thank you. We have three policies tonight. They're all for first reading. First, we have policy 216, student records. The change in this is to reflect current practice. Next, we have policy 222. I'd like to note that the one in the handout doesn't reflect the changes. The one on the link that the school board has does have the changes. We're adding a definition from the regulation into the policy and just changing this from high school principals to the building principals. And policy 702, recognition of contributions to the school community. The only change here is near the end of the policy, making sure that any changes we make is at a public board meeting.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, motion is to approve the first reading for three policies. Any comments or questions? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone
aye.
Opposed? Thank you, Ms. Rothman. We have approval of the superintendent's goals. Dr. Wheeler has presented these goals in detail last month and again tonight. These goals do go into very specific detail in terms of how the district will achieve the goals. So I'll make the motion tonight that the board approve the superintendent's goals for 2016-2017.
Second.
First and second. Any comments or questions? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, thank you. Okay, hopefully everything's okay out there. We have the liaison committee reports. The Montgomery County Intermediate Unit, Mr. Shimoleski.
Mm-hmm.
The mic's not on, Joe.
Quick mic. There you go. Much better.
Okay, thank you, sir. Ms. Hester, the Montgomery County Legislative Committee?
I attended the MCI meeting at the MCIU on September 21st. A number of items were discussed, but we had a guest speaker, Larry Feinberg. But we talked about state funding sources, and apparently there is a funding formula, but there's no funding. So that's basically where we are right now in Pennsylvania. We also talked briefly about the Lower Merion case. The next meeting will be October 21st.
Okay, thank you. So there is a new state funding formula. However, that funding formula is only applied to any new funding. So in last year's budget, there was an additional $200 million for the basic education funding statewide. Only those funds followed the new basic education funding, which is a very complicated formula, but it is available if you really have an interest in looking at that. Eastern Center for Arts and Technology held its first meeting last month. Just to remind the district that next month in November, we are inviting superintendents and director of people service office for a dinner, at which point there will be a presentation of the annual report from last year. I am proud to announce that the cover of the annual report was done by a student from Upper Dublin. So when you do get to see that report, and I know copies are sent to the board, you'll see an amazing cover. Dr. Ludwig, EAC, Educational Advisory Committee.
The EAC met on October 5th. They have completed one report, which I will bring to the board soon and distribute that. That was on a review of guidance. There are three more reports from last year that are still in progress. One is opportunities for enrichment. Another is identifying career paths. And the third is IT and education. And it includes some things on e-books. Then they have four new topics to look at this year. I think they're just getting started on those. One is parent involvement. One is looking at social and emotional issues. One is preschool, and the last one is the experience of Upper Dublin graduates. The next meeting is November 2nd.
Okay, thank you. PTA, PTO, Mr. Kim? This microphone?
On October 5th, the combined leadership meeting met. We discussed at length the hack, and we want to encourage parents to continue to drive the data there so that the PTOs can actually get their directories out. In addition to that, at the meeting, Mr. Sirota and I gave a mini presentation in regards to the roles and the functions of the boards, in which we would like to continue to extend that out to the PTOs. The next meeting is on January 18th.
Okay, thank you. Township, Mr. Shmulewski?
No report.
Thank you, sir. Upper Dublin Education Foundation, Ms. Good?
It's not very exciting. I'm not quite prepared for an Upper Dublin Education Foundation report now, but next month I expect to be able to give a full report.
Super. I know we're preparing for our annual appeal.
Yes.
For the foundation, and we do look forward to your participation in that. Next, solicitor's report. Mr. Roos.
Thank you. First, the Sunshine announcements. There were executive sessions held on September 6th and September 26th. And October 3rd regarding personnel matters. Generally, it's the routine personnel agenda that you see at the regular meetings. That's typically what, typically the week or 2 weeks before, the board will meet in executive session to discuss the personnel items that you tend to see on the business report. October 3rd was also a session where there was some deliberation regarding grievances that were filed on behalf of the various labor unions in the district. And there will be an executive session after this meeting tonight regarding a specific personnel matter. Otherwise, the mention was made of the Lower Merion case. If anybody's not sure what that refers to an order issued on August 30th by a Montgomery County judge joining the Lower Merion School District from enforcing a tax increase of 4.4%, even though the district had properly applied for and received approval from the Department of Education to utilize their Act 1 exceptions. Judge enjoined them from doing that. That order was immediately appealed. The Commonwealth Court has scheduled the appeal to be heard December 12th, and while that is under appeal, the order is stayed and not in effect. That's all I have.
Okay, and that, Lower Merion, if you would apply that to Upper Dublin, that would have meant it was our exception for last year, which I guess, Ms. Bray, was 0.39?
Correct. That's what we used.
It was more than that, but that's what we utilized.
Yes, but the case was so fact specific and so idiosyncratic that I would really hesitate about applying it to any other school district. And I don't personally think that the judge had the ability to do it in the first place. So we'll see.
Time will tell. Okay. At this point, this is our second community input. I'd like to thank all of you that were waiting patiently for a second opportunity. Kindly step up to the podium, state your name and the area that you reside on in the district. And again, we limit community input at this point to 4 minutes.
Again, my name is Zhi Cheng Xu, live in Dresher. And my house is only a few steps away from Mondog Park. That's why I love it and I enjoy it. And I'm glad to hear the school district and superintendent acknowledge the ranking, the importance of ranking. And that's what we want to achieve today. And I will try to set up a meeting with Dr. Wheeler and the school board and to do it further. I do want to emphasize some of the things, like there's an ancient Chinese proverb saying, learning is like rolling upstream, not to advance, it's to draw back. Basically, similarly, that's just saying, not trying to improve the school ranking, and you cannot expect to be keeping there because other township or the school district will move up. If you don't try to improve it, that can only lead to falling behind further. With those comments, I do want to repeat the one I said earlier, and I hope the school district and superintendent will seriously consider that one. Basically, just hand back the questions, the student answer sheets, and the correct answers to the student after each exam, midterm, final, or quiz, verbal or anything. And previously, I got holdback from the school teachers saying it's very hard to evaluate the effectiveness of the education. And to that point, that's why I put on student first. If you say student first, you will not use that excuse at all. That one basically is teacher first. We need to move the teacher out of the cozy zone. And to give that back, you will encourage the teachers to get more effective ways to evaluate the student. Also, school, the main purpose is teaching and learning. If the student don't know what they did wrong, how can you expect them to improve? And also, I think state evaluation is getting harder and harder. That's more important for the student to get those answer sheet questions back. And I can give you examples of why it can be achieved and easily achieved is I went through primary, middle school, high school, and college education in China. All of those schools gave back those things. That's no-brainer. And also even in U.S. college, like I went to UPenn Graduate School, the questions was given to students right away. I served as teaching assistant to Penn undergraduates. It's the same thing. And afterwards, we gave back all the answer sheets as well. I think that's very, very effective. That's the true meaning of the student first. And I'd like to save a few seconds so that Ernst and Dr. Wheeler can answer this question in more details. Thank you.
Try to be quick. Okay. My name is Jin Kai Kong, Maple Glen resident. With all due respect to all our board directors, Superintendent Dr. Willis, and our teachers and administrators, all due respect to your dedication and your efforts, your caring about our school district, our kids. I just want to say, please don't let me get the impression when I walk out of the room that school ranking is not that important. Or some school ranking is important, some are not. And also, I don't believe a dropped ranking or dropped school reputation will help to maintain the market value of our property, let alone to increase that. So that's all I want to say. I'm fully ready to be supportive. I want to be supportive. I support all your work, but I want to see a goal ahead, forward. I want to see school boards, teachers, administrators, residents, students all work together and see how we can improve, get things better. Thank you for your time.
Richard Petrusky, Fort Washington again. I noticed that the extracurricular activities cost is $68,876. And I wonder, is this a budgeted item or is this something above the budget? Because I would think if it was in the budget, you wouldn't have to approve it.
Any other questions? Okay, closed community input. Mr. Russo, do you want to answer one?
Yeah, that assumption is incorrect. Just because something is budgeted doesn't mean it doesn't have to be approved for a specific item. There may be a certain amount of budget for, you know, extracurricular activities. That doesn't mean the specific contracts or allocations doesn't have to be separately approved.
Okay, Mr. Sigafoos.
And actually, probably more importantly, the amount of money is budgeted, but it's the assignment of the coaches or the advisors to each of the extracurricular activities. So they sometimes change from year to year. So they have to be reappointed each year in order to be paid the amount. The extracurricular is an additional to the salary. Yeah.
Okay. In my long discussion to you regarding test rankings, if I implied that they were not important, I apologize. They are important. That's why I spend so much time looking at them and analyzing the data and talking to district administrators and looking to see what we can do to have better school rankings. And before you can have better rankings, you have to understand why the ranking is what it is. What's causing it to be whatever level it is. And it takes a long time to understand that. I think I know now SPPs. I mean, I know exactly how they score the SPPs and where we need to improve. And I know Ms. Morrison knows this, is studying them, and she has an excellent understanding of SPPs and all of the data that and all the rankings. So If I implied that they're not important, no. To me, they are important because it's what the community thinks. If the community's perception is that we've gone down, then it's your perception. Your perception's your reality. It doesn't matter what I think. It's the reality of the community. And we understand that. We understand that. Test policy. Ms. Morrison?
We do have a test return policy specifically at our middle school and high school. There are a number of exams that we don't return home to students without a parent request. The way that the protocol works is that if a student would like to see the test, we highly recommend that the teacher and student sit down together. That would be the first and most important way for a student to learn is by sitting with the teacher. And once that's occurred, then if any parent would like to come in to review that test, they absolutely may do so. Those are only for major tests like midterms, for example, and end-of-quarter tests. I have to say that this is not an unusual practice among other area high schools. Additionally, tests like the SAT, ACT, SAT2, they are not returned either. So it's not that we don't want to return the tests. We just ask, because we do need to have some test security for parents to come in. If a parent is unavailable to come in, we will send that test home. The parent, however, must sign off test security, promising not to share the contents of the test with anyone. So if there is a teacher where you've requested a test and that test, having gone through the steps I just named, does not want to return that, then please contact, of course, first the teacher and then afterwards the building administration.
Okay, thanks. Thank you, Ms. Morrison. And of course, the Keystones and PSSAs, we have no control of those tests. So the students can't see that data. So there's nothing. And those are the scores that that make up the SPP. And a lot of the NEECH and School Digger, they look at PSSAs and PSSAs and Keystones, but we don't have the data to provide to the students or parents on that in terms of what your individual child was weak in or strong in. Any other? Mr. Sroder.
I'd like to make a comment about rankings as well. I also think they are important. I don't think they're important for the reason that many people think they are, but I do think the people who commented on it today were mostly on the mark. So rankings don't tell what they mostly claim to tell, which is how well we're educating the kids. There's some partial truth there, but that is not the be-all, end-all measure of how well a school district educates its kids, and we know that, and we're focused on other things. But rankings are important for public perception of school district. The thing that makes our school district great and all great school districts great, it's not just the teachers and the administration and the curriculum and the facilities and everything that we do to bring all that together. It's really what families do we attract to the district. That's the number one factor. And so rankings are really, really important for that reason. And I agree that we should be focused on increasing rankings, but for that reason and not as a measure of how well we're educating the kids.
Right. Yep. Perception is your reality. The result is you move out of Upper Dublin, that's our problem as a board to deal with that. So, any other responses to any of the three individuals who had questions? And okay, moving on. This is the point that the board. Any final comments from the board? Any final comments from the superintendent? None. Okay. Before we adjourn, I'd like to just bring your attention to the, if I can get to it, to our list of upcoming meetings. We did make a change this month. That the board is aware of, and you will be notified. We're moving our legislative meeting up to the November 7th. November 7th, our legislative meeting next month. The Education Committee will meet on Tuesday, November 1st. Tuesday, not Monday, because of Halloween. I always go out trick-or-treating, so we can't have that Education Committee meeting. And then the other meetings are listed for your information. Also, at the conclusion of this legislative meeting, the board will adjourn to a brief executive session. Okay, seeing no other business in front of the board, motion to adjourn. Second? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you very much for attending tonight. The board will adjourn. Executive session.